I'm going to call this meeting in order. It's the April 13th Committee on Community Resources meeting at 2:30 on a Thursday, which is an unusual time for us. I'm going to note we're being audio and video recorded. And I will note that we have a quorum. We're missing Councillor Klein, who I believe will be coming, but Councillor Carney, Councillor Bidwell, and myself, Councillor Schauer, are here, as is Pam. So we, and I'll note there is no public comment unless Officer Allard would like to make public comment. I don't think so. So we're going to skip public comment. I'm going to ask that we move up item four, and we'll approve the minutes after after this. Move up item four, which is the ordinance relative to taxis and vehicles for hire, in out of respect for Officer Allard, so he can move on with his day after talking to us. So
I appreciate that.
Thank you so much.
No problem.
So if you want to sort of, if you could lay out for us what the ordinance does, what it changes, and why, that would be helpful.
Yeah, over the last year, I've been getting a lot of complaints from taxi companies about other taxi companies saying, why am I regulated to have taxi plates when they're running livery plates? And what happened is when I started looking into the ordinance, both in talking to Wendy Mazza and to Chief Casper, it was noticed that there's really a void in our city ordinance in regards to livery vehicles in general. We really didn't have anything in our ordinance to govern it. Not only that, in further investigation, it revealed that although we were regulating metering in our ordinance, in fact, none of the taxis were currently using metering, and it was kind of an unregulated, we'll draw a circle and you'll pay this fee and you'll pay that fee, which, you know, we're not in the business of saying necessarily what the fee is, but there should be a standard for all customers using that one company. So what I proposed to the chief was actually, can we come up with a definition finally of what a livery is in our city ordinance? Can we clean up the taxi ordinance to govern metering and open up more options for metering that might make it easier for the companies to deal with instead of just a wired meter? And then how do we separate the two of them into two distinct categories so that the liveries know what the liveries regulations would be and the taxis know what theirs would be, which I think would make everybody's job easier. It would make our job, City Hall's job, and the job of the taxi companies themselves to stay in compliance. So that's where this kind of came from. What we really tried to address is, are we running a livery that has markings to be a taxi? And if that's so, is that a taxi in itself? And that's where this necessary definition split came from.
So previously, there was a regulation that they needed to have meters, but that was never enforced, right? They didn't seem to have them, and it wasn't enforced in any way.
For several years, taxis have not had meters in this city.
But maybe at one point they did.
Years ago. Yeah. But I've been here 29 years, and we've had a lot of taxi companies come and go over the years. And really, right now, we're down to two companies inside the city, which that's the least I remember in years.
And this only regulates businesses that are based in Northampton?
Based in Northampton.
Okay. Because we can't control a company that's based in East Hampton, but obviously.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think the idea is to take total control of every company and say, you will, but if you're operating within a company or in the same city, we should all be on the same page and kind of make a level playing field for everybody.
And one of the livery distinctions is that they, it's more like a car service. And you need to, you can't call it anywhere sooner than 12 hours, right? So you need to arrange for.
Right, what I did is I looked at a bill that was proposed to the state. It hasn't been signed into law. There really is no law that's governing livery vehicles. And I looked at the general term throughout the country of what a livery is used as. A livery is used as a carrier service with more than 12 hours notification for a particular fare. The fare is not metered if less than 25 miles, so it's a rate service. And also that the vehicle is not displaying stickers that would indicate it's a cab or a taxi service. which means they can not do any standing services either. They can't pick up fares on the street.
Does anyone have any questions or any clarification?
Just more about this, so that distinction between the livery and the taxi. So if the advance notice of 24 hours, and so it's like takes people to doctor's appointments.
Yeah, I mean, if I have a surgeon on, or a doctor's visit on Conn Street on Thursday, and I call on Wednesday night and say, can I get that service, that would constitute a livery service. Right. It's a prearranged service more than 12 hours. Less than 12 hours would generally be a taxi. Now, the reason this came up when I first went to some of these companies and said, you're not registering your vehicles as taxis, the argument I got back, well, we don't have to. And I said, well, why don't you have to? It says, because we're not doing fares on the street. We're doing radio dispatch, and radio dispatch is livery. So it was kind of a morphing of the law to feed the need, and that kind of defeated the purpose.
So the world of Uber and Lyft is applied to all this.
we did, yeah.
Is that included in the definition of metering with GPS smartphone?
I would say that's Uber is GPS metered, and it's also fare structured by Uber. I have a friend who drives Uber, so this is where I get the knowledge. But when we talk about metering in this ordinance, we're not talking about, you know, you have to get this meter. We're asking, can you get some type of meter, either wired or GPS? I found four apps for my smartphone that did it. So that a client who is told I'm gonna be paying 25 cents a mile can have some kind of reassurance that they're not over mileaged on that transportation. Right now, we have nothing like that. It's really, you know, this is what your ride is gonna cost and this is what you're paying me.
So an agreed upon rate, but how they meter it, as long as it's
mile. This is the copy that I finally finished with Jody Casper, and really, under rates of operation, we struck out the language that talked about the individual rates.
Yeah.
To just say maximum rates of operation must be clearly conveyed to the customer prior to services being rendered. Where before we had this much a mile, and this much a mile.
Okay, so we're not
established. What this allows a company to do is say, okay, we're advertising that our rate is 75 cents a mile, and that's what you're gonna pay. Another company may say, well, ours is 25 cents a mile. Well, that's up to the individual company. But advertise ahead of time so that I know what I'm paying, and then give me a way to validate what I'm paying for, and that's where the metering comes in.
Okay, so we're not establishing rates, we're just
right, and this was after quite a bit of discussion with John Fry as well, when I was asking him about the regulating of the metering, and I think we all came to the conclusion it's not really our place to say how much you're going to pay for a service. Just show me that either by weights or by calibration or by some methodology that I'm getting what I'm paying for.
Yes.
And my apologies for having not absorbed all this in advance, but as I read through this, I realized that because a taxi cab, besides being metered, is defined by stating taxi or cab in a sign on its outside. So in other words, Ubers would not fit this definition.
No, and a taxi with a vehicle with taxi has to be registered as a taxi in accordance with Massachusetts general law. That's where Uber isn't labeling as a taxi service.
Right.
Uber, for all intents and purposes, is operating within a, I guess it would almost be like a livery service.
But is the intent of this is not to find a way to somehow bring Uber within the
No. The intent is to say we have two taxi companies with so many vehicles. I think it would be fair to say they should both be on the same page, and not one operating paying substantial insurances to be in compliance with our city ordinance, and the other one saying, well, we don't have to because we take calls prior. Just a way to kind of set in the ordinance, if you're gonna run a taxi service in the city or a livery service in the city, these are the guidelines for that type of operation.
So if someone has a taxi cab, with taxi cab markings the way that it's defined in the ordinance, and then they have livery plates. That has to change as well.
That has to change.
Okay.
Yeah, you either have to have livery vehicles or taxi vehicles, or you could have both. You know, if I have two cabs in my company and one is a taxi and one is a livery, and you call me on Tuesday for Thursday, well, I'm going to pick you up with this one. If you call me 10 minutes ago and said, I got to get to Stop and Shop, well, hang on, because I got to grab this one. And it almost seems silly to operate that way, but without it, we're at the point where we are right now where, I'll be honest with you, you could call for a cab and take the same cab ride tomorrow, and you're probably not going to pay the same rate.
So the section on, so 316.18, the operator's permit section.
Right.
The last one, so M, it was flagged by Pam, and then looked over by the solicitor. It was recommended by the solicitor that it be a more declarative statement, as instead of saying that taxi cab companies shall submit a voluntary plan, that either we're going to mandate it or not mandate it. So do you have any hesitation about us amending it so that we say
no,
must have?
No, drivers? And I have to be honest, in my line of work, when you hear the word shall,
right.
that means you shall. It is demanded.
Okay.
So that could be verbiage on my part as I wrote this.
Oh.
So I just wanted though to say that the unhighlighted or the unbolded part is actually has not been changed from the ordinance.
Right.
That's the original.
Right. So
yeah.
That's the original language that
right.
was part of the ordinance.
Oh, okay.
And then
yeah.
I suggested all of the modifications
right.
that you're talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah, we modified rates of operation.
Yeah.
We modified
316.13,
and then we modified 316.19 section C.
So I guess my question is, do you have any problem if we additionally modify?
No.
As long as you're at it.
No.
To have it say that it's
yeah.
not voluntary for them to have
yeah,
a
I think
child
I think it's
safety
that that's actually the same, so perfectly. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. All right, so we'll get amending that. Ham, are there other questions that you have that you
I don't think so for Officer Allen, but I did want to ask you that Chief Casper had suggested some language change on the use of the word livery in the definition,
mm-hmm.
and I think you looked at it before the meeting. Is that
yeah.
something that you agree with?
Yeah, what happened is she had gotten some correspondence asking about 159A and if liveries were covered under 159A. And if you read Mass 159 Section 1, that's dealing more with common couriers or bus drivers, which are DOT inspected vehicles. So liveries don't fall into that. So that's where we needed to come up with a clarification of what a livery actually is. And
I guess the solicitor had some wording recommendations based on that.
Okay.
You know, what he said was we can't define livery vehicle using the word livery. So Jody came up with alternative language.
That I haven't been aware made
okay.
aware of it, so.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. That's we have livery plates on these vehicles.
Right.
And they're operating under the guise of a livery.
Can we call the section livery, but we just can't use livery to define
it. Well, it says the definition of livery vehicles needs some revision.
Could we?
Could
we have
used a synonym from?
Well, I'm wondering if you did vehicles with livery registrations.
Well, it says livery registration number plate. Delivery services, is that where the issue is?
I'm not sure.
You can't
I
use
just,
the word,
just
you must not use the word livery in the definition of livery.
So to provide transportation services?
What Chief Casper had suggested is any limousine or other vehicle which is designed to carry 15 or fewer passengers, including the driver, and carries passengers for hire, business courtesy, employee shuttle, customer shuttle, charter, or other prearranged transportation, in which vehicle is not required to obtain a taxi cab license pursuant to MGL Chapter 40, Section 22.
That's what she recommended after.
And she took that definition.
I believe we had conversations about that. Yes.
So I suppose I'm asking is, are you okay with
that? I'm in agreement with that. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So we'll also amend the definition of livery to remove the word livery, but include this definition of what it is.
And get to that point that way. Yes.
Okay.
Complicated.
Some things are more complicated than you think they're going to be. Okay. Were there any other things that you were flagged that you wanted to ask about?
I don't think so. I don't really think that it had the changes that I had identified would have been under the.
Yeah. There's actually very few changes to the ordinance.
Right.
It's literally it's just a way to clean up a small portion so that everybody's happy.
Yeah, but I think the problem was that, you know, there are other changes that need to be made because the city council has introduced changes over time through other means, and somehow they didn't get reflected in the ordinance book, so.
I've
clean up some of that as well.
I've had officers asking me, you know, what are we charging these people, and I'm trying to tell them it's kind of hard to issue a ticket on an ordinance that really isn't even up to date to what we're dealing with. So it's kind of handcuffed us a little bit.
And I guess one other, how are we going forward? How will we, check in that they're using the app, or what sort of regulation are we going to do on that?
I know for the liveries, one of the things that we talked about, and it was in the changes that I suggested to her, that the livery vehicle or the definition of the livery vehicle have a pre-completed scheduled trip sheet including the following information of the current date, time, month, year, and the name of the vehicle company, the licensed owner, the name of the driver, the vehicle license plate, the pickup time, the address and phone or the person who was picked up, and that these would be records that would be maintained.
Oh, okay.
So if there was an inspection that took place, we would be able to articulate that, you know, in fact, these weren't liveries and you have to operate, you know, as a taxi for these. Not to, you know, punish, but as a way to kind of get us all on the same page. As far as the metering, that's a little bit harder. I think the one thing that in technology today, if I know the rate that you're charging me, I can open my own app and I can verify what I'm being charged to the rate that you're charging me. So in a way, I think it's almost open metering on the part of the person who's doing the auditing. That's going to be almost the fastest way to assure that people are paying the right price.
And so all the paperwork that you just described, or those sheets, that's more than that has been asked previously of the companies, right? To keep those kind of records?
For the vehicles that were operating with the livery registrations, that is more.
And when you met with companies, I know only one company came, right? But were they, you know, open to doing that?
The one company that came asked, why do I have to meter? Uh-huh. And when we were explaining that we were trying to level the field, and if, you know, you're complaining about the person operating under livery auspices, then if you're going to operate under taxi, you should operate under taxi, right? And I was amazed that the information or the feedback from him was, well, that's fair. You know, I'll do metering if they're going to operate the same way. Unfortunately, it was just one of the two companies
right.
that came to the meeting, but I didn't find a lot of refute from the one operator.
Okay, good. Sounds like maybe we're all gonna be on the same page.
Hopefully.
Does anyone else have questions for Officer Allen?
It's been helpful.
Yeah, it's gonna take a little bit of time, and I the Uber thing, that's a whole other monster that every other city is dealing with, and I hope it, you know, in some state, maybe the state takes more regulation of that instead of the cities. All right, well, hey, thank you, everybody. Thanks for moving on this and looking at it. I do appreciate it.
Thank you. We very much
appreciate you coming. Have a pleasant
one. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Okay, so
I have to ask a question. I mean, this is such a complicated issue for us because in the city clerk's office, they are sort of interpreting the ordinance to mean that the ordinance applies only to taxi cabs.
Okay.
So that if there was some sort of requirement to all of a sudden have livery service companies come under this umbrella, come under the taxi, or excuse me, the taxis and vehicle hire ordinance,
right,
then someone really needs to look at this ordinance again with that sort of interpretation, that it not only applies to taxis, but it also applies to liveries as well.
Okay, by someone, who do you mean?
You know, and this is what I, you know, this is how we got into this sort of discussion in the first place. It doesn't really seem like anybody owns the ordinance or owns, you know, wants to take ownership to sort of get it to a place where it's enforceable and, you know, we can do something about it. So if we move forward with this today, the way that the city clerk would handle this is she would only ask for an operator's permit and a registration of vehicles for taxi companies. Mm-hmm. So that if someone came in and said, you know, I want to register as a livery company, she would say, we don't have liveries in Northampton. So now what I'm hearing is if we are going,
even though they've been operating with livery licenses in Northampton.
Well, this is the problem. So the ordinance has always been written that the vehicle for hire was only a taxi company, not a livery service.
And so if the ordinance is amended in this way, there would be permits required. It looks like there would be some sort of permitting required for the livery vehicle.
We don't have a fee structure for liveries in any way, shape, or form. We never did. It was only for taxis.
So you're essentially suggesting that we're starting from scratch with this.
Well, it sounds like, you know, what I'm hearing is that there's a desire to enforce livery, you know, but this has not been, you know, sort of vetted to have that.
The issue is that it's Uber and so forth are going to fall under livery, and the state attorney general is now crafting legislation, and so anything that we create is going to be subject to that. So I feel like we might be putting the cart before the horse in doing that now at the city level.
So what's happening right now is, as I had described when Officer Allard was here, is that there are taxi cab companies who are operating with livery plates on them. And the reason is because insurance costs are a lot less to operate a livery service than to operate as a taxi cab. So that's what I think he's trying to accomplish, is to correct that and enforce it. So one company that is playing by the rules, following the ordinance, and doing everything is paying a lot more money to run his business than somebody who is opting to do this other thing, and it's sort of not really fair.
And so we have to have defined in the ordinance the livery thing in order for him to say, you're not really a livery service, you're doing taxi work. So really it's more about, it's not so much about the regulating them as livery vehicles, but telling them they're really taxis.
Right. Well, what I heard Officer Allard say was that he wanted to enforce them as liveries. he wanted to be able to check their records and do anything that was, is defined in this ordinance.
To keep.
But.
If they're gonna be a livery and not a taxi.
So we have to create a licensing process for livery, as we were saying, and so we are, we're starting scratching some of them.
So what makes this even more complicated, and again, you know, I think you're right, that it's probably gonna be better to just start from scratch, is that we've never collected business owners' permits for even the taxi companies. So when city council would review and approve taxis, they never had a business permit, the overarching business permit. They only had the vehicles. So you only approved vehicles. Even though it's been in the ordinance for years, we've never, there's nothing that's ever been collected and followed this sort of procedure. The operator's permit, I didn't see any problems with that. The registration of vehicles, you know, there's some missing information that's not collected when you take into account what's in, you know, what's required. So, you know, there's just a disconnect, and I had put my questions forward to Attorney Seawald. I think he did a pretty good job answering them in terms of, you know, what needs to be required. And then when I talked to him, he said, well, why isn't anybody, you know, enforcing the ordinance? And I said, this was long before, you know, I ever even thought to look up the taxi ordinances, you know, just so.
So what do you think we should do? I mean, how do we proceed? Do we make, you know, there are certain amendments we could make today, but in terms of this sort of whole second piece that's like a structure that needs to be created, how do we handle that in terms of doing what business we need to do today and forwarding it on to legislative matters?
Well, I would recommend that you look at the changes that are being introduced here, decide whether or not you want to accept them and move that forward with your recommendation to legislative matters. But before you sent it on, that you reviewed it again and looked at it from the perspective of, you know, will this fit into, you know, accepting livery? And that would require the attorney, the city solicitor, to look at it again, because he was, you know, he was plainly told that it does, no, even when you put the definition in there, we don't tackle liveries at all. So even
from the clerk?
Yes. So even he has the impression that, okay, this is only talking about taxis.
Okay.
Now I'm confused again. If there's an ordinance that makes a clear distinction between a livery and a taxi service and makes references to licensing requirements, then there shouldn't be that much room for discretion in the clerk's office to decide.
I don't think it's discretion. I think what she's using it as is as a gate to what needs to fall under this particular ordinance. Do you know what I'm saying? Because no one has ever looked at this to say, okay, will a livery business fall under this?
It's like we're excluding a whole class of transportation service.
You know, so now you gave me a definition to, so now I know, all right, if somebody has livery plates, I don't do anything with them. That is the, you know, the sort of interpretation, because again, the rest of the ordinance has never been addressed to deal with liveries at all. I mean, it may just be a quick look at it to say, okay, yeah, this will fit with, you know, livery as well as taxi, but there is the possibility that this is once you put all the pieces back together, it's not gonna serve the livery businesses.
Well, it would seem to me that is there some sense of urgency about this ordinance
I'm going to say no, because it's been like this for, since at least 2006. And if there was a sense of urgency, we've already passed it, because the taxi companies have already come in to apply it under what they thought was the procedure.
Right.
And you guys are going to be approving that probably on the 20th.
Okay. So happening before.
So we're talking about maybe a new company that comes in, or, you know, the licensing process for
right.
next year.
So none of this would affect pending licenses that are coming to us here this month.
I wouldn't want to be the city council.
We have to consider them essentially grandfathered in the process.
Yeah. But as I mentioned though too, you know, even the way it was written originally in 2006, we're not following that process.
Right.
You don't do a business license for taxi companies at all. There's a business certificate that's filed with the city clerk's office. It's sort of a fictitious name / DBA.
The DBA, right.
And then there's an operator.
But that's how it's been interpreted. But this sort of suggests it's supposed to be done every year. There's some document that gets put to the business, and they are supposed to hang it in their office.
Or whatever else.
So if there needs to be an additional procedure done in the clerk's office, who determines that? And
well, you do by ordinance.
Okay.
I mean the same thing that happened, ordinance or order, because we put that order through about fair wage.
Can we ask the city solicitor to actually craft it, though? I mean, it just seems like it's so technical. I mean, or we could look at, I guess, what we have in ordinance for secondhand goods dealers or something like that, and just craft it based on that, no?
I think that you're going to find the same issues with other sort of things. And it's not just with city council stuff. It's with, you know, that's the way the book is. You know, it needs an owner. It needs somebody to say, this isn't, you know, what we do. And, you know, clearly this isn't what we do. It's not what we've been doing. And, you know, and even when I talked with the city solicitor, or actually his comments suggest that, well, you know, I asked him, you know, what about this operator's permit? Because I wanted to know, is it something in the, you know, in the MGL that's a requirement?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's, you know, so he came back to me and said, well, the city council needs to decide what they want to do. Okay, well, there's an answer. Then I know that if you guys accept whatever is before you today, then, you
and
know.
Then it may need to be revised based on what happens at the state level.
Yep.
At some point.
Well, his reference to the state level was with regard to Uber and Lyft, which in any event, I don't think there's any interpretation of this that would apply to Uber and Lyft, if I heard him correctly.
Because they won't be defined as livery?
They wouldn't be defined either as livery or as taxi.
I mean,
right.
I weird said they're
a whole different
livery
animal,
wouldn't make
they're
sense.
Not,
but that's
affected.
What I'm saying, at the state level, they're trying to figure that out.
Right.
Right.
So the
he's
thought
saying
was that
we'll
totally,
deal with them another day.
Yeah, totally separate from that. Let's get our own issues of livery and taxi sorted out here, knowing that the Uber issue is a totally different issue, hopefully to be sorted out at the state level. That's what I heard him saying.
And if they were defined as livery, then that would...
We just have to comply with whatever we create around.
It wouldn't make any sense, because what we're creating around livery is that you have, it's got to be 12 hours ahead of time. I mean, it just, practically speaking, wouldn't be what they do.
Well, this
right.
is why I'm saying
right.
we would have to revise,
right.
if they get defined at the state level as livery, we'd have to revise our legislation to be compliant with the state. But that's down the road, we don't want to worry about it, I guess.
Partly because I'm just coming to this and didn't in advance read all the back and forth with the solicitor. It is pretty confusing, and it just seems to pretend that we've got the fix now, it just seems like it almost needs a little working group of city clerk and solicitor and someone from the police department to just sit down and as if we were starting from scratch. If we were just based on the logic of what would it look like if we were starting from scratch? I mean, what did you mean when you said it's like we need to start from scratch?
Well, I think you have a pretty good foundation. I just think, you know, there are pieces of it, you know, I think, I mean, if you went through the note that I had put together and, you know, went through that and, you know, I think I did a pretty good job trying to say, okay, this makes sense kind of a thing, and this is a process that we could have. But there are just pieces of it that really are the responsibility, I think, of the city council to decide, do you want this? Do you want, you know, businesses to get a new license every year to operate a business as a taxi, in addition to the DBA, in addition to the operator's permit?
So they don't get a new business? They don't get a new license every year?
No.
So that's not something we're adding now, is it?
It's not what you're adding.
But it's what's on the books now and not being enforced.
What Pam is suggesting we create, essentially.
It's not being followed. Not enforced.
It's in here in the ordinance that they need to get a business license every year, and that's not being followed. And
they don't have the forms.
Right.
And they don't have, any of the tools.
So we're not really doing in the city clerk's office what's already in here, and now we're adding in two other things that are not to be done.
Right, and the city clerk has her own interpretation, which is separate from the police department, apparently, right? Because now he's saying, well, we want to enforce, and the city clerk is saying, well, no, the liveries aren't even, that's just telling me what I don't include. So
it's not that we have to start from scratch. I misunderstood that. If we already have this language, and it just sounds like it's a procedural issue in terms of rolling it out.
Well, it could be that.
In which case, that's not actually our domain. It's whoever oversees the processes of the city clerk.
Because we haven't done it for so many years, right, and you guys have not enforced that piece of it, then right, maybe you need to look at it and say, okay, do we really need
Let's
it?
Let's get rid of this. So, you know, looking forward to seeing this. We're not asking
or
for business licenses. Let's take it off the books.
Yep.
So,
okay. Except if we don't require a business license, then we have a lack of parity amongst the businesses that we're approving.
I know this is so confusing. I'm sorry. I'm probably not even doing a good job at this. The business license that the taxi companies do file is separate from the business not the operator's permit. It's called the
business owner's permit.
The business owner's permit. The business owner's permit has specific information that it's looking for. It's filed every year, and there's wording in here that suggests that if you're not in compliance with the ordinance, then the city council has the authority to go in and revoke your business owner's permit. What we have been doing is we've been saying, okay, the DBA, the business certificate that gets filed with the city clerk's office, which is really a DBA, is serving as your business owner's permit. So we're talking, it's an additional cost. This is a $50 per year requirement that's on the books. The DBA is $50 every 4 years. Okay, so I'm not sure where the disconnect came from as far as, you know, how the interpretation is so different than what's outlined here.
Okay. So, do we feel like
it's very complicated?
Yeah. As a committee, do we want to take this on as something to revise and sort out?
Pass it on to the TPC.
It's already been to TPC.
I mean, you guys said that. Well, they did look at it, but you know, I mean, you need somebody, I think, who's been, you know, part of the working process, the working, you know, I came from the city clerk's office, I can tell you what we did. We didn't do this. And then when I saw it, I was, you know, I was like, well, wait a minute. You know, a lot of this just is not.
We have a no taxi cab shall be made so closely to resemble the taxi cab of another as to mislead the public as to its identity.
I know there's something like that.
I feel like
it's old. It's just that it probably was there before when it got there.
Ultimately, our goal, it seems like, should be to make it as friendly to the owners of these companies as possible, which might mean instead of strengthening the what exists and enforcing what exists, figuring out how it's redundant.
Well, I don't want to suggest that it's redundant, because there are very specific requirements that are outlined in here that are, you know, you may look at and say, oh my, we really should have this on the books, because, you know, we want to be sure that the business is insured for $100,000 and, you know, that they have, you know, whatever other requirements were part of that business owner's permit. I mean, you might say, you know, off the top of your head, you might want to say, yeah, let's just get rid of it I think you really need to look at what's required as part of that and, you know, make a conscious decision that it's not something that you want, you know, to enforce, or, you know, geez, these are really good, you know, ways to help protect, you know, the public, or whatever the case may be. Because they got there somehow, and they're very specific and drawn out and, you know.
So in the rules, how much time do we have to move this forward? Act on it?
I think it's 45 days or something. Maybe you could ask for an extension or
do it at our next meeting.
Yeah, but I'm not sure that, speaking for myself, that I have the background to add a lot to the solution.
Well, if we have the solicitor to come and
ask the city clerk, perhaps.
Ask the city clerk, that will be here when she's ending her time. But yeah, if we asked the parties who could help us figure out the right system.
You know, and the other thing that I suggested to Councilor O'Donnell was, you know, just move forward what the police department wants now and address this, you know, this bigger issue, you know, later. You know, because what I think the police department is asking for, you know, they can enforce however they interpret what they put in here.
Right.
They feel comfortable with that.
Right.
And then, you know, tackle some of these other more, you know, complicated issues, you know, at some point.
Yeah, maybe there'll be more legislation later on, too.
Well, that does sound like a way.
Temporary way out. Do you like that?
Well, it also is a way to say there will be a new city clerk, an interim, but in November, and maybe the new city clerk's gonna have a lot of things on their plate. But maybe when there's a new city clerk, the more comprehensive sit down to figure this thing out. In the meantime, we take care of the technical fixes that the police are looking for. Knowing that down the road there needs to be a sort of a solicitor, clerk, counsel sit down of some sort to really figure it out.
There are a couple simple fixes that I think you probably might want to, you know, recommend, and that is you no longer have the Committee on Public Safety, so that should be changed. And then there's a section in there on fees, which refer to section 174, which the city council eliminated a while ago.
Right.
That whole section.
Where's the reference to the public safety committee?
There's more than one, right?
There's three, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Three references.
Okay, should we, what's everyone's pleasure? Should we make the amendments we can make, which would be,
You wanna change those committee on public safety to the committee on city services, just search in place?
What is it?
To the committee on city services, which does public safety now.
Yep, so.
You could just search in place, well, I mean, I know you can't just do that easily.
I mean, before we start making, so, do we want to make the amendments we can make and move it along? With the note that there are substantial procedural things that should be addressed in the future, but don't keep us from enacting what's here at the moment. Or do we wanna take this on now and try and get it all done? I think, I take your point, Councilor Bidwell, about the new clerk, although I think there's also an advantage to having the person who's dealt with this for so long talk to us about how it actually looks in the office, as opposed to someone who's new to all of it. Although we do have, you know, Pam is.
Do her position until?
June 30th, is that right?
June 30th, she will be.
So we essentially have two more meetings of this committee before she leaves.
Right.
If we get it on the agenda for next month and the month after, if necessary, or one or the other.
Right.
Because I agree with that. I think that it makes more sense actually to have someone who has an understanding of how the office operates to help facilitate whatever we decide.
And we're lucky to have the treasurer, that is Pam, who comes with that knowledge also.
Right.
So I don't know if it's necessary, but I think there's an advantage to.
Well, I think Wendy would be able to provide you with a perspective of how it came to be that the business certificate sort of replaced the, you know, the business owner permit, or, she can certainly help us understand why that happened, you know. But, you know, I think, you know, my biggest concern was when I sent it out was, you know, I wasn't sure how much of this was regulated by state statute. So that's why Attorney Sewell, when he came back and said, it's really what the city council wants to do. I said, okay, well, yeah.
Okay, so am I hearing me? Do you want to take this on in our next meeting and invite the solicitor and the clerk?
Through the mayor's office, is that how we do that?
Well, I don't think so, because she would
clerk's
need...
Clerk's independent.
Yeah, she would need a solicitor, an invitation directly.
Right, so the solicitor we can invite directly too, right?
Yes.
Anybody else?
I mean,
Do we want like the chief to come and to have the police come back and talk about it, or do we think they've done their part? We don't need.
Yeah, this is procedural, not related to them. If I'm understanding what we need to do correctly, that makes sense.
Is there any precedent for asking the solicitor and the clerk to confer in advance and put their heads together and come forward with something? I know that's not. But otherwise, we're gonna have the solicitor tell us what he thinks. And then we're left with having to pull it all together and craft it ourselves.
That's why I was hoping we could actually have the solicitor create a draft for us of what it needs to look like legally.
Yeah, I would love to ask the solicitor to confer with the city clerk, confer as needed further with the police department, and provide us with a draft that accomplishes these things, but I have no idea if we can do such a thing.
I think he's going to ask you what you want to accomplish.
Well, that I think we could agree on. The objectives that we want to accomplish, how it translates into specific procedures and language, I think it would be very difficult for us as a group to do.
Plus,
there are legal questions at stake here, because as I understood from what you said, Pam, there's this question about, you know, what kind of insurance are these companies paying, and is the city going to be held liable in some way if in fact they're not? So there are very specific legal things that we can't address because we don't have that knowledge.
Right, and that sort of, you know, that sort of was a question that I had, that those limits that are in the ordinance itself, you know, seem to, I mean, they were enacted in 2006, so, you know, who's to say that, you know, that the recommendations haven't, you know, been bumped up, or, but I wouldn't even know the first place to look for, you know, where those, and how those recommendations would be determined is beyond me. I don't even, I'm not really sure.
So can we do what Councilor Bidwell is suggesting and ask the city solicitor to confer with the city clerk and create even a first draft for us to kind of have at our next meeting?
To make the ordinance language more consistent with what's the practice? Is that what we'd want them to do? Because if she were to look through that, like you said, there's many things that
the legal
just doesn't really happen.
So I, to be perfectly honest, I'd be happy to do that. I'd be happy to, you know, take the recommendations that Attorney Seawald already gave us, put those into the document, send them to both him and Wendy, and say the committee is recommending that they, yes, they apply to liveries as well as taxis. What would be, you know, can you guys take a look at this together and sort of
We'd be silly to decline.
Well,
you're sitting in the middle of all this with a better understanding than any of the rest of the
And she's already done a great deal of work on it.
Well, you know, it's sort of...
I would have suggested it, but I didn't think it was my place to suggest it. But now that you...
To be perfectly honest, I mean, I think I, you know, I'm sort of sitting in the catbird seat, sort of listening to everybody's feedback. Well, the attorney, you know, how come he doesn't know this? And then I'm saying, why does the, you know, city clerk think that this is something that, you know, is no longer going to apply? And she led the city solicitor to believe that, nope, this is not going to apply to liveries. Okay, well, since you're defining liveries, though, and you want to exclude them as part of your process, then let's make sure we have a good definition. And that's how it got left in that conversation, so. I'll put that together, but I do need to know. Do you are you interested in having the business operators?
Business operator permit.
Permit. Is that something that you
want?
Well,
you were saying that it's an additional. They already have the DBA that rolls up every 4 years, and
so
then this will be an annual renewal.
Okay, so the DBA itself, again, there's this component is in the ordinance itself that sort of suggests that if you don't have the operator's permit, then the city council can revoke your business owner's permit. But you can't revoke a DBA.
Right.
So.
I see.
And to get a DBA doesn't really mean much.
It's just a fictitious name.
You walk in with your check.
You can go in and get one.
It implies nothing in terms of any kind of requirements, inspection.
Yeah. We haven't been asking for this business owner's permit as long as you can remember, right? And this
Never.
Is, right, and this, it's extensive, the whole section. So it's either, you know, if someone were being a stickler and there wouldn't be anything we could do, well, if it says we're gonna, if the consequences of revoking the permit, but they don't have one on file, we don't require it.
Right.
So that's more of a discussion with the clerk's office too, I think. I mean, there must be some rationale for, or it might have been just a simple thing for why we stopped asking for that.
I don't know that it ever was asked for. You know, I think really, you know, that, I mean, I'm sure you're aware or you recall that there were instances when something was revoked and it was the operator's license.
Right.
And I think and there was this question when that operator's license was, you know,
So that person could no longer have, could no longer drive a vehicle.
Yeah.
But then there was a question, well, how do you get this, you know, this driver who's also the owner, you know, how do you put teeth into it and, you know, no longer allow him to have a business or someone who, you know, has violated something.
Yeah.
You know, you wouldn't have been able to do that without something somewhere.
Right.
I think we should have something somewhere.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I would be in favor of having the business owner's permit, which okay. would be something that we, you know, if they were not in compliance.
Okay.
It would be some kind of leverage.
Okay, so that would require a form, which I'll put together based on what wording you have here.
And since we're having, there's going to be a new clerk, this will not be a, everything will be a new thing that
everything
person
will
have
be
to
a
do.
New thing.
It will not be an added, this will be a,
literally an added burden.
Yes, it'll just be
for anybody.
Part of what they do.
Okay.
That is my opinion. Anyone else would like to voice an opinion on it?
I think that makes sense.
You guys thought it was just going to be cake doing this.
No,
I was so excited that we finished with the first part. I was like, oh, we moved that long.
Okay, so thank you for your offer to do all this, Pam. We very much appreciate it.
No problem.
So additionally, we're going to, so we'll amend the definition of livery to not include the word livery, to define what a livery is. We'll amend the child safety
okay.
section.
Yeah.
And he already wrote language for that, I think.
I believe he did,
right.
Yes.
And the, we'll do a find and replace for.
Yep, city services, you
city
want
services.
However, can I just point out that one of those references is, if the chief of police denies an operator's permit, then the right of appeal would be to what now says the Committee on Public Safety.
Right, that needs to be replaced.
Yeah, to
so it is, apart from just to find and replace, is that what we think is
that's
the appropriate
the
procedure?
That is the process, yes.
Okay.
So, you know, it's sort of like, you know, the executive side has sort of made a decision.
Right.
You know, they appealed to the legislative side to sort of.
And we did that.
Yeah, we did.
Previous,
yeah.
Whatever.
Okay.
And I think the mayor was, you know, was, and the chief came to the meeting and
yeah.
Okay.
What do you need from us right now in terms of a motion? Do you need a motion? Do we need anything, or are we kind of?
Like, it would just be a.
I don't think you have
a sense of
right.
the committee that.
You
yeah.
yeah.
So we're
continuing.
Yeah, that's what I would do.
Okay.
Continue it.
So is there a motion to, was that a motion? Did you just
to continue?
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No objections, no abstentions? Okay, so we are continuing this issue. Pam is going to very generously draft that and be in contact with the city solicitor
yep.
and the city clerk. And we will take it up at our next meeting. Great.
Excellent. Thank you, Pam.
Thank you very much, Pam. Okay. So we're going to go back to item three, which is approving the minutes of the last two meetings, so February 21st, 2017, and March 20th, 2017.
I'll move them as a group.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any discussion on the minutes? Either? No? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No objections, no abstentions. Those are approved. So that brings us to item five, which is discussing the op-eds pertaining to the CSR, first one of which went into print on March, what was it? Hi.
Hello. Is this a meeting?
It is.
Quick information. I would like to get in touch with the representative at large, the councilman at large.
There are two at-large councilors. None of them are here present at the time, and we are actually in the middle of a meeting.
Is there a website or a
the city website? If you go to the city website, which is northamptonma.gov, there's a city council section, and all of the councilors are listed. It's councilor.
I did it already. I didn't see a websites for him?
He's looking for Ryan.
There's counselor, there are two. So there's the council president, Bill Dwight, and the vice president, who's Ryan O'Donnell.
Yeah.
And they're both here. We're going to pull it up for you right now. And we don't have a way to print it for you, but...
No, I'll memorize it.
Okay. Would you like a phone number, or...?
Yeah, that would be good.
All right.
A piece of paper.
Anyone have any blank paper?
Yeah.
Great. Thank you. Okay. We're going to write that down for you. And we're in the middle of something on the floor, so if you don't mind, I'm going to continue. Is that okay?
I'm sorry.
Not at all.
Do it, but, you know, I'm here in the building, so...
That's true. Actually, the city council office is actually in City Hall.
This is meeting room, chambers?
True. But generally, unless there's a meeting happening, we're not in here.
Maybe
so this is our administrative assistant, Pam Powers, who's in the city council office, which is in the first floor of City Hall. Okay, so we are discussing the op-ed, the first of which ran in the paper.
I don't recall the date.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And so, well done. And the second of which we are supposed to be...
So just as a little bit of background, Dan Moulton was quite interested in there being what we described as a series of three, and I wasn't sure if he would include in the tagline that this was the first of three, but he did. So there's an expectation of numbers two and three to follow. I've heard from various folks. I'm just curious if there's any other reaction, or did it come across as too positive, too Pollyanna-ish?
I'm just curious if
anyone's here and heard anything to the reaction.
Yeah, I actually didn't. I was surprised that I didn't get feedback from it. But what did
I only heard from my friends who said nice job.
Okay.
But
you didn't hear it that it was too Pollyanna-ish.
No, but. I do think there may be a little bit of that out there, just because there is some growing concern about some stuff, you know, totally apart from solicitation and wage theft. The fact that the Bob and Bill's chocolate emporium going
right.
out and shop therapy is expanding
right.
into that space. That's drawn some attention and
yes.
raising some concern. My God, what is our... Yes, we're...
Foundry closed now too, I think, right? So there's a whole...
Really?
Three quarters of that block.
Was the Foundry closing?
That's what someone
told
me.
That's a different block. Oh, really?
But three quarters of that block
is
storefront.
I didn't know.
There's the concern about the type of... About shop therapy?
Yes, yeah. The concern is it's not... there's continuity. It's not going to be a vacant space, but... Are we becoming a downtown of head shops and T-shirts and you know?
Which when the Mountain Goat went out and that went in, that's what people said.
And at some point you hit reach sort of a tipping point of what the essence of downtown Northampton is now. I've heard some of those concerns, not having anything to do with the op-ed piece, but just because of recent developments.
Right.
I was just curious if anyone else is picking up on any of that.
Well, I mean, I certainly hear concern, not in relation to the op-ed, but I've certainly heard concern. It sort of dovetails into the articles that
right.
you and I both shared, where
right.
this is not unique to Northampton, and it seems that people are looking for more of sort of experiential retail as opposed to just straight up retail. And that's actually something that we heard during at least one of our public forums from the woman whose name, Nancy Cohen?
Nancy from Happy Valley.
Yeah, Nancy
yeah.
from Happy Valley, who had said the same thing, that she really feels like that's the trend, that people want experiences as opposed to just things. You get things anywhere, and so she felt like she was trying to create more of that sort of thing in her retail space, and so it's.
Well, I think experience is what, you know, events, right. Festivals, right. Happenings,
right.
That bring people to retail, sometimes done in conjunction with retail. Yeah, that's.
And the idea at this moment in time, what people want is to have an experience, but it's even maybe more important to share that they've had an experience on social media. And so they want it to be packaged in a way that they can then show that they had this experience. So it's like, these are sort of conversations I can't believe we're having. But you know, is it worth thinking about how do we create not just more opportunities for experience, but how do we create more space where people feel photogenic? I don't know. I can't do it.
Well, I mean, that's not unrelated to one of our recommendations, which was that there be some kind of, I think we wound up in our report calling it just a one-time forum where the arts organizations, the downtown organizations, talk about the role of events and arts programming in relation to generating activity and visibility and good vibe and good storyline for downtown. And that's a recommendation of ours that still sits out there. And as a matter of fact, that's one of several things I talked about with the mayor that want to fill us in on.
Okay, great.
But so we had said that a next piece, and I drafted one knowing that it would need considerably more attention and discussion than the first one, would say, yeah, there are challenges, and we've thought about them, we've heard a lot about them, here's how we either have responded or think the city should respond. And it turns out that the mayor did take us up on our recommendation to a, we suggested appointing a, I forget what we called it, a panhandling and at-risk downtown population task force. He, in fact, has appointed, I think what he's calling the mayor's panhandling advisor. And this group met last week for the first time, and it's a really good group of folks. It's what we were suggesting.
Can you tell us who it's made up of? What kinds of people, at least, if not the names?
And let me, yes, absolutely. It's the social service organizations, the housing organizations, a representative of DNA, a representative of the chamber, Peg Keller, the police commissioner.
Any business owners?
And one business owner who is serving as the chamber rep.
Okay.
Any social justice organizations involved in that?
Well, I would say these are organizations that have social justice, you know, kind of embedded in their DNA. They're not necessarily single purpose social justice. The reason I'm in anticipation of our discussion about this next op-ed piece, and also in anticipation of one of my e-newsletters that I send out periodically. I asked the mayor, okay, so this group is up and running. You described it as being informal, and you wanted to keep it that way. You didn't want it to be a lightning rod. You wanted a group of people that you kind of walk, just be able to talk among themselves very, 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 very frankly in order to, over a period of months, actually, perhaps come up with something. And that is kind of the vibe and the understanding. And so he said, as far as he's concerned, this is his thing. We asked him to appoint a group. It's his advisory group. He asked me to serve on it as representative of this body, but it's the mayor's thing. And his desire is that, sure, we can talk about it. He's formed it and talk in general about the sorts of organizations that are there, but he doesn't want, you know, names identified, the specific individuals or the specific organizations that are represented, although, you know, it's the usual suspects. No
that's the, and there was an initial meeting that was just focused on everybody kind of sharing their background and their perspective. Peg Keller is going to continue to facilitate. The mayor will participate actively in all the meetings. There's been a great desire to schedule meetings only when all 10 or 11 people can be there. There's a next meeting been penciled in for May. The thinking is to meet for three times, four times. The focus of the next meeting will be everybody who's got any kind of data as to who's out on the streets and why and what and who they represent. Anything that can be done to get a better handle on, by then we'll know what happens once the shelter closes the end of April, for example. And anything we can do to get a better handle on how it divides up between folks that are, in fact, in the DMH networks as absolutely mental health issues and folks not. But as well, and this was a reminder to me that there are folks soliciting for money for their own well-being. There are some of the most aggressive solicitation is the nonprofit organizations that are out there. And then there is a population of folks who are not soliciting at all, but they're just increasingly part of the community of life on the street. And so the next meeting will be primarily just any data that any organizations have, including coming from the police department, from other parts of the city, and the social service organizations and the housing organizations, to just sort of better understand who's out there and to the extent that there is any kind of seasonal pattern that would help to understand the situation. So that's basically what happened at the first meeting and the plan for what would happen at a second meeting. Oh, there was also a suggestion that we come to the next meeting having learned a little bit about what has happened in New Haven. New Haven had launched this program, which in many ways you would describe as sort of a blown-up version of the Happy Frog. A series of kiosks with a lot of messaging that a lot of organizations spent a lot of time figuring out just what this messaging is. And inviting folks to, if they want to continue to directly give money to folks, great, that's your right, that's their right. There's also an alternative channel that's been set up. If you put money over here, it goes directly to the shelters and the food pantries and the social service organizations and the addiction programs and one thing and another. So there's a desire to just understand, how's that going? Has it had any impact? Is there anything known about it? So there's my rambling catching you up to date.
I appreciate that, thank you. But I'm also concerned, I know that I have another meeting here at 4 o'clock,
right.
So we only have about 10 minutes left, and I have some responses to the letter, and I'm just concerned because if you need to get this into the Gazette before the next meeting, that we have time to do that. Because I'm not sure that I want to be sent on to this unless it is.
No, I understand it. And once we were about 45 minutes into taxis, we began to dawn on me that we may not get to closure on this at this meeting. It's I don't think it's not the end of the world. The Gazette readership is not going to, you know.
So my question, did you discuss a timeline with Dan?
The general discussion was one in March, one in April, one in May.
Okay.
But, you know, I don't think it's the end of the world at the Gazette or for the Gazette's readership if there's...
Did you send that letter? I don't know why I don't see this.
From the 27th.
Both these letters were at our previous meeting.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's right, because we have...
Yeah, I sent out a more polished draft of the first, a rougher draft of the second, knowing that the second was gonna generate, you know, more conversation. So at the very least, the second one would acknowledge that the mayor has appointed this advisory group and it's up and running. Talk about it in very general terms. And there was language in there about how the city did respond to what we learned about the wage theft issue in terms of the resolution, the mayor's action, the council order, and then just, you know, pertaining to activities, events, experiential activities downtown. This one day gathering of the, or one session gathering of the arts organizations. The mayor is not too excited about that. His position is that that's what Brian Foote already does, and he convenes groups regularly, and the mayor can't stop the city council from convening any group we want. But he was quite interested in following through on a recommendation on the Panhandle group. He's less enthusiastic about creating some totally separate meeting, planning session, whatever, and so we need to think about a committee. Is, you know, do we still put that out there that that's our recommendation if we know the mayor's not going to follow?
Well, I mean, it's out there, but you can choose whether or not to follow. I mean, I think we talked about that they convene together under sort of different umbrellas at different times. So whether it's, you know, the there's like the downtown arts, there's a name for it, there's a term for it,
there's the Paradise, what do they call it, the Paradise City, Paradise City Cultural District is a fairly, theoretically fairly large umbrella under which all this can happen, and there is apparently a plan to develop sort of a three-year time frame. Under that umbrella, and the mayor suggested that could be basically what we were talking about, but without having to set up some separate thing. So I guess my bottom line is, because that's still a little open-ended, and because we haven't really had a chance to talk about that initial draft that we put out there, that maybe learn a little bit more about the arts event possibility. Planning possibilities. Think further about the language that was in this first draft, and then I'm trying to do it today, but come back to our next meeting and sort of skip a month and all that.
Okay, as long as you're comfortable with that, I think that's fine.
I'm totally comfortable with not trying to get that done.
Okay, so we'll continue the discussion in the next 5 minutes. You don't do that? Well, so we'll continue the discussion and revision, I guess, of this letter and also of...
Yeah, what I would propose to do is in advance of the next, you know, based on what we already know about some things that have changed since the first draft.
Right.
And if, in fact, there's more to be learned about this planning, this a more comprehensive planning process under the auspices of the cultural district, mm-hmm. then I would make a stab at reflecting some of that. So we've at least got a somewhat more up-to-date draft to talk about as a group than we can, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that would be great.
I have a question, kind of tangential but related. When the mayor kind of stands up this kind of ad hoc committee, is it not subject to open meeting law?
That's a good question.
I believe that that's true, because
we're just wrapping up, we promise.
Apply to,
that it's not?
I think it's true that it's not subject, because it applies to elected officials.
What?
You mean our vice president?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're just wrapping up.
Elected and officials appointed to establish committees when it's ad hoc.
Except if we now have the power to create an ad hoc committee, I can't imagine that it would be subject to
that. It's warm here.
Anyway,
that's just a question I have because I was very surprised by your comment about how we're not publishing the names and we don't have access to the conversation that's happening there.
Well, and that's why I do want to be most careful. I don't know clear plan for how to do this and get results without some kind of rabbits and things. And I don't want to muck that up, but I also do want to be clear that we're in compliance. So let me get clarity.
Yeah.
Okay. Clearly,
it just feels like an incredibly crucial issue that there are very strong feelings about, and it just seems like the kind of conversation that a lot of people would want to have access to. So I'm hoping that that's not the case. That
I think it's one of those things where the feeling is it might be way less productive.
As is true of everything. 90% of what we do. The last. Okay. So we're going to continue that discussion. Does anyone have any new business? No? Then, can I hear a motion?
Motion adjourned.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.